Margaret Raymond, thanks for your time on today's Choice Media interview. We appreciate it.
Bob, it's good to be here.
So you're going to give a talk in a few minutes about New York City charter schools, and what do you plan on talking about? What are the main points?
Well, I think that there's good news to be told about New York charter schools. The performance over the last 5 years, as we've been studying it, is really positive relative to what charter school students would learn in their traditional public schools. So that's the good news. The slightly less than great news is that there's still a lot of room for improvement. And when we compare New York City with other urban areas, we can find other areas that actually have substantially greater results for charter school kids.
Okay, so but within New York City, there's a large range in performance, obviously, which I suspect might be true anywhere that you go. There's a range of performance. And so it's interesting that there's, from that range, the very top to the very bottom, would it be fair to say Success Academy was towards the top, and it's the one that was targeted by Bill de Blasio?
That's certainly true. Although I have to say the range of quality in New York City is a lot tighter, and it is more positive on average than we find in other communities. About 65% of the schools of charter schools in New York City are doing much better in math than the traditional public schools with whom they compete. In reading, it's about 25%.
There are lots of ways charters are being differentiated now. It used to be considered one monolith, essentially. Charter schools are, you know, good, bad, in between. And now we're seeing them differentiated, for starters, in the cohort of students they accept, right?
So that's absolutely right. 20 years into the charter school movement now, we can see that there are actually very different groups of schools, and their missions take them in different directions. So we have a lot of schools that are intentionally targeting communities where students have been historically underserved. So they're minority and poverty students that are dramatically behind where they should be in terms of their age. And there are other schools that are actually exercising choice instead. They're addressing a different population of students, and they're trying to offer something different than the public school, but not really having to worry about whether they are recovering students from an academic deficit.
Right. So the first group, more like recovery schools that help kids who are struggling. Another category, more like magnet schools for kids that maybe are doing fine, but just pick another option.
That's right, Bob. That's a really good analogy.
And so I guess the message is that authorizers and other people who look at charters need to begin to make these differentiations when they assess.
That's right. There are certain universals to authorizing that you have to be very careful about who you give a charter to in the first instance, because it's very hard to chase a school after it's opened. And New York City does a great job in that. The three authorizers that are giving charters to operators in New York City are all very focused on quality. And so the necessity to go in afterwards and actually close down bad schools is much less in New York than we see in other parts of the country. That's great news. But beyond that, because schools have different focuses and different agendas, essentially, in terms of the programs they wish to offer, I think there needs to be a little more nuance in the kinds of reviews that they get during their term and at the end of their charter.
It is an interesting dynamic in New York City where you have three different possible authorizers of charter schools. In many places you go, even just across the river in New Jersey, there's only one authorizer of charter schools, the State Department of Education. What is the effect of having multiple groups that can authorize a charter, at least in the case of New York City? What's the effect of multiple authorizers?
So the effect of multiple authorizers is that there's an incentive for charter operators to be very strategic about who they go to receive their charter.
Strategic.
And we don't see this playing out in New York City as much because the authorizers are pretty strict here. But in other places in the country, we do see authorizer shopping, and it's quite blatant. Here, the focus on quality gives them very little wiggle room. Okay, they're going to get treated about the same wherever they go.
So in your view, there's not much difference, the fact that there, maybe there's just more overall charters, though, because they're multiple authorizers. Is that fair to say?
Well, so I think the New York City Department of Education clearly has a strictly New York City focus, where the other two authorizers, SUNY Charter School Institute and the State Department, actually have more of a statewide focus. And so I think that there's actually a little bit of difference in terms of where they want to try to put their emphasis. The quality message is consistent across, but I think geographically they're focused slightly differently.
Let's talk politics. It wasn't so long ago, back around, I guess, 6-7 months ago in October, 18,000 parents marched across the Brooklyn Bridge to protest Bill de Blasio's remarks that were just speculative at the time. He wasn't even mayor yet. There hadn't even been the election. He wasn't even mayor-elect yet. And they were just hearing that he might charge rent to charter schools. He might kick out schools that were co-located in buildings with regular district schools. How do you assess the political landscape in New York City? How has it changed since the deal between Andrew Cuomo and Bill de Blasio?
Well, certainly there's been a calming of the roiled waters in the charter space, and that's a good thing. What I'm hopeful that we will see is that there will actually be more of an opportunity for a creative exchange between charters and traditional schools. Co-location is a really interesting experiment in New York. You have charter schools that are close to but not co-located and others that are co-located. And so it would be really interesting to see what kind of knowledge transfer happens in those two groups of schools to see if, in fact, the very presence of charter schools that are highly successful can be, in fact, a support to other schools that are operating in the same communities.
In social media, there's a term, a hater's gonna hate. And so I wonder what you would have to say to people who dismiss the charter movement as they just cherry pick the best students, they kick out, find ways to counsel out the special needs kids. They basically, it's easy for them because they just get all the best kids to start with.
So my basic fundamental is that I'm not for charters or against charters, I'm for great schools for kids. And the bottom line for every parent, and I would hope every member of the community, is are we preparing kids appropriately and adequately for the life that happens after K-12. And the data are what the data say. We have very strong examples of really great public schools, and we have great examples of strong charter schools. That's a place where there's a lot of opportunity for exchange and collaboration, and a deeper focus on what is good for teachers and kids to make outcomes for kids better is where I think the opportunity lies. And haters eventually are just going to get over it because the emphasis is about the kids.
And the movement's growing too, right?
2.5 million students are enrolled in charter schools and 1 million are on the wait lists.
But the trend, of course, is that more will be approved, and so some of those wait lists will, well, I don't know, maybe even more parents will apply ultimately, but it does seem like it's growing at a fairly robust rate, 8-9% a year, something like that, right?
In certain parts of the country, it's growing that rapidly, and in others, there's a big push to curb the growth. And so the hope is that the success stories that we see in places like New York City and Boston are actually prevalent and actually prevail over the arguments that are being brought to bear in other communities.
There's a federal charter bill that was passed by the House of Representatives, which is now before the Senate. You have any thoughts on that?
Well, I find it unusual that the federal government is choosing to weigh in on essentially a state issue. And the fact that they're wanting to put so much of an emphasis on the expansion of charter management organizations without a parallel focus on quality, I find troubling. If they were to say only quality CMOs and they got all kinds of benefits in order to rapidly expand, I could be much more supportive of it.
Charter management organizations being the larger charter groups as opposed to, say, the mom and pop type charter.
I'm sorry, I should have been clear, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so bottom line, in terms of the movement's growth, where you see this in a few years, if we were to be sitting down 5 years from now talking, would we be looking at about 5% of kids are enrolled in charters today nationally? What do you think we'll be looking at?
So I think there are two important frontiers of evolution in the movement. I see successful schools, whether they're mom and pop or networks of schools, being pressured to grow very quickly because the need is so great. And I see charters being asked to specialize in school turnaround, where they're asked to go in and take over failing schools. That's a very different model. And where we see that happening across the United States, there are really significant challenges. It's very different to start a school and be successful from day one than to go into a school that's been failing and make that a successful school. So I see those two directions as the two things we'll be seeing 5 years from now.
Okay, so this is really my last question, which is that isn't quality in the eye of the beholder? I mean, at Credo, at Stanford University, you guys are assessing the quality of charter schools, but one might argue that different parents may define quality differently, and they have a right to define quality differently, and maybe different kinds of kids need different kinds of emphasis based on how schools design their curriculum and their discipline and all kinds of factors. And so the idea of a singular metric or barometer of charter quality, some have a problem with that because they say our needs aren't the same as our neighbors.
So I would argue that all schools need to be evaluated using multiple measures. Academic progress, I would argue, is the primary one that we should be looking at because that's the metric that determines whether or not students are going to be self-sufficient when they graduate and are able to go on to other things.
Margaret Raymond of Credo and Stanford University, thanks for your time today.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.